have a pleasant, contemplative, good Tuesday evening to all of you out there in television land. I am Chad Halley, and once again, I want to welcome all of you to Idea 336. You tuned in to Jazz in the Modern Era. And as always, we're coming to you live from the campus of California State University, Dominguez Hills, over LA 36, its local affiliates. And for those of you who sit in front of your computers and follow us, we come to you via the internet. You see a toll-free number on your screen. It remains our phone number into our little room here on campus at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I invite your calls. We will be with you through 10:30 this evening. Those of you who follow us via your computer, you see your address on how to reach us, dhtv.csudh.edu. And another reminder that for those of you who've missed prior broadcasts, this is session number 7, by the way. So the 6 prior broadcasts, you can check them out via YouTube, youtube.com/csudhtv. So please take advantage of that if you need to. Again, I want to welcome all of you to another session, and I've got some special surprises and some very special music for all of you out there listening. We kick things off with a gentleman I had the pleasure of meeting, oh, good heavens, maybe 8 or 9 years ago. And he has done this program on several occasions in the past. Roughly 3 years ago, he relocated to Portland, Oregon. He is currently in town and will be in for another couple of days. And I had to have him back on the program because he brings an element to this music that is so ear-opening. At least it's been that way for me and anybody who's heard this gentleman's music over the last several years. A very special cat has rejoined me this evening, Mr. David Ornette Cherry. David?
Hey there, Chad.
Welcome back, man.
Good.
Great to have you. Oh, it's a pleasure having you. By the way, David has brought in some special things, including an instrument you see on the desk here that we're going to have the pleasure of hearing in just a moment. We open things up with a composition by my guest entitled Memory. It comes from the Hillsboro Story. It's a soundtrack to an extraordinary story that I'm going to let David share with you in just a moment. Recorded roughly 2 to 3 years ago, and you kind of got a feel for all that soundtrack is dealing with this opening, again entitled Memory, composed by my guest, Mr. David Ornette Cherry. Man, you moved to Portland.
Yeah.
Clear air, I'm sure.
Good air. They really think green up there, and I like that too. And it's a small community, good transportation. And it gave me a chance to refresh and see where I was as an artist.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And like I said, in the wilderness, and you get that feel of Native American.
That's important.
Country up there.
Mm-hmm.
I was just did a whole tour in the Northwest and seeing from the coast to East Oregon. It was beautiful.
In addition to touring in the Northwest, you're still getting out to the other side of the USA.
Yeah.
And then down to LA. You did a recent gig at the World Stage.
Oh, that was beautiful.
Yeah.
Oh, thanks. I'm just so happy. That was really for Billy too. I felt his spirit, and it gave me a thing to be grounded in foundation. So it was a great gig with Reggie Carson, mm-hmm. and Ollie Elder Jr. on bass, and John L. Price on African percussion, Don Littleton, and then the young lady Don Northfleet on flute and vocals, and then Richard Grant was even there, so he got to sit in
playing some rousing trumpet.
Yeah, and then I found out my cousin, which was James Cherry. And if those of you who know about, like, let's say, Ricky Cherry, he played the piano on Brown Rice with Billy Higgins, but his brother was there, so he played congas. But he has a son named Nishan Cherry.
I see.
Who plays trumpet.
Mm. Oh, man.
So it's another Cherry.
Yeah. All those guys fit on that stage?
Oh, yeah, we had it working, and people came out, which was nice, and so it was a good homecoming for me.
You mentioned Billy Higgins.
Mm-hmm.
And again, for those of you who may not know, the World Stage was co-founded by one of the greatest drummers who ever lived, Mr. Billy Higgins. And anytime musicians come to town, they generally, as a rule, try to make it over to the world stage to pay tribute and honor to the great Billy Higgins. And David, being in town for a relatively short period of time, felt that he definitely needed to get to the world stage and share his music.
Yeah.
And again, pay tribute to the great Billy Higgins. Wow, early in the program and we already have a caller. So let's quickly take that caller and then we'll continue with the music. Mike from Torrance. Mike, welcome to Jazz in the Modern Era. My guest, David Arnett Cherry. Mike, you're on. Go ahead, please.
Yeah. Chad, I was a principal of a school in Inglewood, and a teacher by the name of Collins, Naomi Collins, was one of my teachers, and I just wanted you to know, you recognize John Collins, the
great guitarist, yes. Mm-hmm. Go ahead, Mike. You asked the question. I missed the question. Ask again.
I wanted just to know if you played any music by him or...
Oh, by John? You know, this particular semester, Mike, the answer is regretfully no. But as you mentioned, John Collins was one of the great giants of the guitar, often overlooked by the general public. Even some of your hardcore jazzers aren't familiar with John Collins' work. But I'm glad you acknowledged him. And maybe we've got another 8 weeks left in the semester. Maybe we can pull up some great John Collins and share.
I really enjoy your program. You do a wonderful job.
Thank you, Mike. Appreciate the kind word, as always, man. Great. David. Memory from the Hillsboro story. Tell the viewers what that's all about, if you would.
Well, you know, Chet, it's a beautiful story. It's written and directed by Susan Banyas. She's from Ohio, Hillsboro, Ohio, and she lives in Portland. So I've been working with her for about 4 years, 5 years. But the story is pretty basic. It's about this young girl, Susan, in the eighth. She's like 8 years old. And she's sitting in her classroom, and the teacher is reading Scarlet's Web. And outside her window is five African American women, protesting to get their kids into the school. It's right in 1954, 1956 with Brown versus Education. So she went back 50 years later, and talked to the people, and 'cause the town I'm trying to be clear with this. The town buried the story, right? And so she got the real people to interview the real people and used it in the play.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then there was this white man who burned, he was a county engineer, and he burned down the black school, the Lincoln School, because he said it was unfit for the students. So it was a whole controversy with that. And it was the first test case in the North for the Brown versus Education. So the memory part is in the beginning of the play, which is very beautiful. It's like what you might say when she recalls going back to tell the story.
And you captured that beautifully in that tune. I mean, so contemplating.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
You can't help but wonder, what's next?
Yeah, and and with history now, with the play is... and I'm understanding with our memories, is history is not something that somebody brings out and say, this is history. History is from our foundation, from our memories, and then what happens around that memory.
It's a living history.
Yeah, yeah.
It's not in a vacuum. It's not static. Yeah. It continues to evolve.
Yes, yes.
Which is what the music is all about.
Yes,
right?
Definitely.
Evolution. Mm-hmm. And time permitting, I want to get into that issue with regard to not only your music, but the music I've been featuring throughout the semester, the whole notion of revolution versus evolution.
I like that one.
David, your music has always struck me as being not only forward-thinking, but also with regard to thinking.
Mm-hmm.
Your music and the manner in which you bring it all, fuse all of these elements, you can't help but think about these elements, some of the history, who it's connected to. Mm-hmm. And this next tune, I think, reflects that to a great degree. This next piece that we're going to feature, you're going to recognize a gentleman who was a giant in the literary community, novelist, playwright, poet, columnist. I like to call him the sage of the Harlem Renaissance. And David did some very, very special things with this particular gentleman's legacy. Check it out. We'll come back.
Pick up my life and take it with me, and I put it down in Chicago, Detroit, Buffalo, Scranton, Harlem, any place that is north and east and not Dixie. I pick up my life and take it on the train to Los Angeles, Bakersfield, Seattle, Oakland, Salt Lake, any place that is north and west and not south. I am fed up with Jim Crow laws, people who are cruel and afraid, who lynch and run, who are scared of me and me of them. I pick up my life and take it away on a one-way ticket. Gone up north, gone out west, gone. But of course, up north and out west, anywhere that people live, their problems of one sort or another, but the old problems of Jim Crowism, segregation, and terror, well, they're usually left pretty far behind. You don't find the excesses of race prejudice in northern or western cities. And so, here is a poem about a girl who is graduating in, let's say, in a town like Chicago. Pick up my life and take it with me, and I put it down in Chicago, Detroit, Buffalo, Scranton, Harlem, any place that is north and east and not Dixie. I pick up my life and take it on the train to Los Angeles, Bakersfield, Seattle, Oakland, Salt Lake, any place that is north and west and not.
Wow. That's some pretty heavy stuff.
Yeah, fun too.
The great Langston Hughes, for those of you who maybe not, are not familiar with Langston Hughes, Google Langston Hughes and learn something about the Harlem Renaissance, its impact on the world, and in particular, the life of one of the great giants, literary giants, Mr. Langston Hughes. David Cherry is my guest. David, talk about this particular track. This is from David's latest release entitled Organic Journey. It was released in 2009. Just talk about it.
Well, I like being in theater now. I've been hanging out with a lot of writers and stuff. Mm-hmm. So just to get me into how I'm going to compose for theater and stuff, I have to go back to the beginning.
Yeah.
And that was Langston Hughes. Now, I'm from Watts, so... when I was growing up, we had at Gompers had a show called Young Souls. I think I talked about that.
He's talking about, for those of you who may not be familiar, Gompers, now middle school, then Gompers Junior High School.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So we had like a theater group that we used to travel around and do. And most of the points we did was Langston Hughes.
Makes sense.
You know, so I found this CD mm-hmm. of Langston Hughes reading his poetry. And so
doing the Hillsborough story and those issues, mm-hmm. and then thinking about my family coming from Oklahoma to here,
right.
and the retreat to the West or the South, I related to that. Mm-hmm. So I really wanted to do something with Langston Hughes. And so the whole organic journey thing was, I had to do it. And mm-hmm. there's another piece that I did the same thing of grabbing an artist and throwing it over a track.
Yeah.
Very important artist, Langston Hughes, and for poetry, writing, and social, you know, issues.
On the right path.
On mm-hmm. the right path.
Yeah. I pick up my life. One-way ticket, Mr. Mm-hmm. Langston Hughes.
And we know about that. We all have to pick up our life.
And again, in listening to this, when David and I were talking previously, I was again reminded of the impact of that landmark decision, 1954, Brown versus the Board of Education of Topeka, Kansas. And back in my professorial days, it seems like 100 years ago, I used that landmark case as a prelude to talk about the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, where rights were being extended, you know, ideally to all. And in listening to this particular track, those memories came
flooding back. It's interesting. See, I benefited afterwards because then it was the Watts Rebellion, but it seemed like when I was going to elementary school mm-hmm. after the rebellion, mm-hmm. We really, the community was more Afrocentric. We started, so we kind of benefited from the from that later on.
Absolutely.
And I relate to that.
Sure.
So Langston Hughes, I think a lot of people should just go out and research it themselves and really rediscover his music.
Absolutely.
I mean
his art, absolutely.
Which is music.
Sure. Yeah. Langston Hughes, in addition to writing some thought-provoking prose in different subjects, much of his subject matter revolved around the music we've been featuring throughout.
Jazz, right?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Our next track is going to feature a gentleman that many of you who are jazzers, you're very familiar with this gentleman, who happens to be the father of my guest. This gentleman worked with any number of musicians coming out of Texas who relocated to Los Angeles, namely people like James Clay, Billy Higgins, who was from Southern California, Ornette Coleman from Texas, and again, the great trumpeter, pianist, composer, world music pioneer, Mr. Don Cherry, David's dad. We're going to feature Don Cherry, and David's going to share a story of how he put this particular track together. But again, featured out front on Pocket Trumpet, the trumpet that he made famous, Mr. Don Cherry. Thank you. when Don Cherry joined Ornette Coleman on that renowned trip to the Five Spot in New York City and set the jazz world on its ear, 1958. Believe it or not, wow. And that music, when you listen to it today, it's still considered pretty revolutionary. My guest, David Ornette Cherry, is with us this evening. And this particular track, we just heard a portion of it, features his dad, Don Cherry, on pocket trumpet. It's from David's latest release, as well as the previous track that featured Langston Hughes's oratory. Organic Journey is the name of the date, and David will share some interesting stories. In fact, why don't we do that now? Talk about The Voice of the Silence featuring your father.
Well, you know, the whole organic thing came from my father, the Organic Music Society, organic music. And so that's where I really came into the music, learning as a musician the organic music. Mm-hmm. That's where I came in. And so when I was doing this On the Right Path, I already have done a few organic records, and this was going to be the last of the series.
Yeah.
So I figured that I needed to have Don on there at the end as I figured it out, what I wanted to do. So I found this track of him just doing the trumpet by itself, and I already had the rhythm stuff happening, mm-hmm. tracks done,
mm-hmm.
which is, if everybody listened to it, it's pretty much like a Cordona. It has the Native American, which Don was about, because I'm part Choctaw. It has like the North Indian, it has the African drums, it has the Brazilian with Nana Vasconcelos. So you have all these elements,
yeah.
and then it just fit perfectly. Mm-hmm. And I miss my father so much, and it really spoke to me
mm-hmm.
in that sense. And where I was going to go, since the record was called On Organic Journey, now ready to take that journey, and I felt like I was on the right path, and that was the last piece on the record that put me into where I was going to go next,
yeah.
wherever that might be, you know, because the adventure is always in the music. You
oh,
know,
man,
you know?
Absolutely.
So,
by the way, before we take our next call, I do want to mention, if you want a lot more information about my guest, David Ornette Cherry, some of his projects, the things he's done, his discography, just simply go to davidornettecherry.com. There's that website. And provide a lot of information that I think you'll find very, very valuable about this very special cat to my left. Let's take a call, David.
Okay.
We're on with David Ornette Cherry and Chad Genie from Hollywood. Genie, welcome back.
Hi.
Hi.
Chet and David, good to see you here, David Ornette Cherry.
Hey, Jeannie.
Hi. I'm glad that you're back with us on the show this evening.
Thank you so much
for being with us. Are you going to be here long?
I'm on the road pretty much. Like we was talking about the Hillsboro story, I'm pretty much on the road, but I was passing through because I'm doing another theater piece that will be coming here with a writer, Terry Wolverton, called Inverse, that I'm working on while I'm here. And that should be exciting. So I think we're going to be doing that pretty soon in Los Angeles. But I'm pretty much going to Topeka, Kansas, to do where the Brown versus Education, the first elementary school that the case was about, that was tested there in Topeka. So we go there, and then I go to Cincinnati to do the Hillsboro story at the Freedom Center, the National Underground Freedom Center in Cincinnati.
And all that's on your .com, right? Your schedule?
I haven't updated that, but you can, if you go to like SusanBanez.com, that's SusanBanyas.com, SusanBanez, and look for the Hillsboro story, or just, you know, Google the Hillsboro story. You can find more about what we're doing with that. But
okay.
I haven't updated my website, but you can find my discography, and there is a soundtrack for the Hillsboro story on iTunes or something, or you can find that. But it's good to be back in Los Angeles.
Yay.
It's a
I'm
swing,
really
we did the stage, baby.
And I wanted to say that, you know, I'm excited for you that you're doing this work, because I've been in several conversations, especially since the situation in Arizona with the shooting of Gabrielle Giffords, a personal friend of mine, is a very dear friend of hers, was very disturbed by that. And it was suggested that we as artists really need to use music at this time to bring this universal truth to everyone so that we can sort of create a new renaissance again. I mean, over and over and over, this is our task. This is our job.
Yeah, I like that. I think the people need to take over what they, and you're seeing that in the world now. And I think the people, we need to stand up for the rights and civil rights, because civil rights, we look at it sometimes that it's just happened in the 60s and the 50s. Civil rights is right now, you know, right now.
The kids don't even know about that time. I mean, even the L.A. riots, people go like, "What? You know about the Watts riots. Well, you mentioned the Watts Rebellion. Well, I mean, there's kids in school right now don't even know about the L.A. riots, what happened not that long ago. And it's important for us in our history that we really preserve what we know, and the music that we have is such a rich legacy. And you mentioned Langston Hughes already, and he's the one. He has a brilliant quote about Randy Weston and his piano playing. I have to say that. You know, that's the first time I ever heard of Langston Hughes because of Randy.
Yeah. All right, Jeannie. Jeannie, thank you for calling, as always.
I've enjoyed the broadcast. Thank you.
We appreciate that you're out there. It's nice to know that folks who love this music, but also practitioners, are out there enjoying what we do. Thank you, Jeannie, so much.
Yes.
All right. Wow. Great. Our first film of the evening is going to feature leading this extraordinary orchestra, a gentleman who played with Don Cherry, David's dad, and Ornette Coleman in that very, very important band from the late 1950s and early 1960s. Namely, Mr. Charlie Hayden and his Liberation Music Orchestra. And in order to help continue our look at connections, this tune, as an opening, connects with an artist we featured earlier, Mr. Langston Hughes, because the first track of two that we're going to feature for you is entitled Dream Keeper. And for those of you that are familiar with Langston Hughes' work, one of his extraordinary set of poems is entitled Dream Keeper. Going to feature Charlie Hayden's Liberation Music Orchestra. They're going to do Dream Keeper and segue right into Feliciano Ama. This is Charlie Hayden's band, recorded in 1992 at the Montreal Jazz Festival.
Thank you.
right, we're going to break in here, regretfully. What you have been hearing is Charlie Hayden's Liberation Music Orchestra recorded in 1992 at the Montreal Jazz Festival. The theme is Dreamkeeper, closely associated, obviously, with Langston Hughes. And you heard that remarkable bass solo by Charlie Hayden himself, who, by the way, as I mentioned at the top, performed with the father of my special guest, performed with Don Cherry, Ornette Coleman, in that extraordinary band of the late 50s, early 60s, when Coleman and Cherry were shaking them up. Anyway, just quickly, some of the cats in the band. On trumpet, you heard Ryan Kaiser and Tim Higgins. You briefly saw Robin Eubanks. What a family, the Eubanks family. Robin Eubanks on trombone. The saxophone section included cats like Joe Lovano, Javon Jackson, and Makonda Ken McIntyre. You briefly saw Mick Goodrick on guitar and the drummer Bill Stewart.
Wow.
A quick aside, the great, late great James Williams is on piano on this particular date. Charlie Hayden's Liberation Music Orchestra. And for the sake of time, because there's so much more to share with you, I'm going to go into our next feature. This gentleman, who I've known for a number of years, I've had the good fortune of having him right here on campus to join me on Jazz in the Modern Era. Simply one of the baddest cats in the world on his instruments, namely the saxophones, clarinet, flute. And my guest, David Ornette Cherry, pianist, player of an instrument that very few even dare try, the melodica, but also a renowned composer. And he wrote this tune that Justo Almario is going to play. It comes from a 2004 date entitled Love Thy Neighbor, the tune very simply entitled Mali, written by my guest. Enjoy this. We'll be right back. You just heard a genius, in my view, the great Justo Almario on tenor saxophone, mm-hmm. playing a David Ornette Cherry composition entitled Mali, which has a very, very special meaning for him.
Yes.
Recorded in 04 from the date Love Thy Neighbor. Justo Almario on tenor, Donald Vega, who I fortunately had on the program several years ago on piano, mm-hmm. Rene Camacho on bass, and Lorca Hart on drums. David, talk about Justo, briefly about Charlie Hayden and what you just heard in the film.
I'm going to go to Charlie Hayden first because mm-hmm. I love his sound. I love his political, how he puts the music and want to say something in the music. Mm-hmm. I really appreciate his mentorship for me and the love of the music and how it can go on. But we always have to say the music has to have a consciousness and a spirituality, and that's what mm-hmm. Charlie did. The Liberation Orchestra, some of those older recordings with my dad, and you got Dewey Redman's and some things is great, and it goes back to really the Jazz Composers Orchestra, which my dad started, which is some great recordings. So you mm-hmm. can just go through those, research it out there and go out there and see what those records sound like. Mm-hmm. But a very orchestrated improv music, but it had that consciousness and mm-hmm. spirituality. Mm-hmm. Justo is a mentor, and every note means something to him. He just doesn't play a note without it meaning something, mm-hmm. you know. Just playing with him, I have learned a lot, and he will take a piece and get it, you know. And I'm honored that he did the Mali piece because we traveled and we was playing it, especially in Europe and stuff like that. And when I first heard it, I had tears because he's you know what he did with it. So I'm honored with that, and he's continued to play music out here. So if you can follow that out there. Find some Justo's music or go see him play. He plays at Charlie O's.
Oh, he plays at Charlie O's in San Fernando Valley on occasion. Yeah. And he's a prominent member of Jose Rizzo's Jazz on the Latin Side All Stars. Mm-hmm. Just look for that name, Justo. That's with a J. Justo Almario. Yeah. And he's a remarkable musician and one of the most spiritual musicians out there.
Yeah.
Absolutely. David. Folks out there know you as a pianist, mm-hmm. player of the melodica and other instruments, mm-hmm. composer.
Yes.
But also I know you pride yourself on being an educator as well. And this next tune in some ways is going to demonstrate that. because it's going to feature a young woman in middle school.
Yes.
singing some, dealing with some consciousness raising.
Yes.
You want to talk a little bit about that, set this up?
Well, the interesting thing, Chet, was, we always learn to learn the music, own the music, and then give it back. So I like to, teach students and basically like theory. But when I had a theory class at this SEI middle school in Portland, summer camp, I was just teaching basic theory, but then we had some studio time. Mm-hmm. So I had a chance to get the students into recording. And this young lady, I noticed around the campus, and I've been noticing when I go out and teach, that a lot of the students are saying, quit hating, or that term been coming up. Which I think is very profound because we should quit hating. Hate is very
bad. Hate is ugly. Hate is destructive. Uh-huh. Absolutely.
So yes. I found it very nice that the students were saying this in their own vocabulary. So we came up with this tune called Quit Hating, which is a nice theme. Very simple, but it means a lot. And really, and she's going to be an up-and-comer.
And her name is?
Savannah.
Savannah.
By Savannah.
Right. So we're going to feature Savannah,
mm-hmm.
David Ornette Cherry's music. Again, the tune, Quit Hating. We'll come back.
Why are you hating on me? Why are you hating?
A very simple tune, but pretty profound lyrics, by all by a young middle school lady, woman.
Savannah.
From Portland, Oregon, huh?
Yeah, and you know, and we did it on one take, so she was pretty much heard the stuff and did it, which I like. And she's going to be an up-and-comer. Mm-hmm. And I don't know what else we said. I was going to mention something, but
okay, it'll come back.
It'll come back
as we feature this.
Yeah, but in the schools, I think the students are really having issues with dealing with different cultural things, and they really want to talk about these things.
Yeah.
The Hillsboro, we've been going into the school systems, and on the second act, the show is one act, and the second act is question Q&A, and the students have so many great things what they've been dealing with, and we need to listen to them. Mm-hmm. And mainly it's racial issues or racial slurs, how they've been treat each other, mm-hmm. and they've been dealing with that. So I think as parents or elders, which we talked earlier about, how they need to get with elders. We need to get these stories to the kids so they can understand where they come from and those stories that they won't get lost,
mm-hmm.
because the elders are leaving fast and leaving it up to us. So I think with these kids, they reaching out trying to, they need us to go back and really get them the stories, and it's because of their history, how they can move forward.
Well, any educator worth their salt needs to provide opportunities for young people to dialogue,
yes.
and to understand each other, and to not only always consider differences, but consider the similarities, what makes them alike.
Mm-hmm.
And so we're so busy dwelling
yeah.
on differences. Well, you know what?
Yeah.
Kids from all different backgrounds and races and
yeah.
groups have so many similarities.
Yeah.
You could start there and then perhaps weave in how we address these differences. But
and we need a language for that, too. They need a language how to communicate this language
mm-hmm.
to do that, you know.
And how one avenue can be music.
Music, thank you. And
absolutely.
Art.
Absolutely. Again, David prides himself on being an educator and working with young people. Our next video is going to feature a gentleman who I've had on the program practically every semester for the last 7 or 8 years. And I'm honored that he continues to join us, and very often he brings in some of his colleagues and they play a little bit. And you've heard me mention the fact that he is an instructor at UCLA and also at the University of California, Irvine, UCI. And this film features Mr. Charles Owens. Specifically, it features him setting up what you're about to hear. It was recorded in 2006, and let's let Charles Owens describe what you're about to hear.
Put together to demonstrate that some world-famous jazz musicians were born right here in Los Angeles, which is a little bit north of Orange County. We'll leave it right there. This next selection was written by Charlie Mingus when he discovered that Eric Dolphy had passed, and it will feature Brandon Robertson and Max Hamer playing So Long, Eric. Thank you.
Two youngsters, stars in their own right. That was Brandon Robertson on vibes and Max Hamer on piano, both members of the UCI Jazz Orchestra under the leadership of Mr. Charlie Owens. Hopefully I can get Charles to talk about what you just saw when he comes and joins us towards the end of the semester. This was recorded in 06 in Anaheim, California, as part of the Black Chamber of Commerce of Orange County. They presented a little gathering called the Cotton Club West, Putting on the Ritz, recorded live at the Grove in Anaheim, and it featured, among other musicians, the UCI Jazz Orchestra, led by Charles Owens, doing Mingus's So Long, Eric. Again, Charles Owens, the educator, my guest, David Arnett Cherry, the educator. These guys are working with young people and showing them the path. Very often these kids come with chops, but still need some guidance, some direction, and encouragement. We feature David Arnett Cherry, the composer, David Arnett Cherry, the performer on record. Now we're going to feature David Arnett Cherry in performance live for you for just a brief bit. And talk about this remarkable instrument you're going to play and go for it.
Well, this is this is a spirit flute, a Lakota flute made out of cedar, and I've been playing this for about 4 years. Mm. And so I just was up in the Northwest and I found a guy who makes them, mainly for like Carlos Nakai, so I'm getting some new ones made for me. And I just wanted to play it for my ancestors. I'm part Choctaw, and I come out of Oklahoma, Arkansas, and other places. But I just wanted to share the spiritual side of the music and what is taking me to the next step to continue to adventure into the music. But I want to share this with the audience, so I'm going to play a little bit.
I heard so many influences there. My goodness.
Yeah. A beautiful flute.
Native American influences.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Lots of elements on this remarkable flute. And so often we forget when we hear a musician play an instrument, particularly one that's made out of wood, just what the wood itself can do to the sound.
Yeah, and then plus, you know, the whole myth of the story, and I tell the story all the time, is that pretty much this hunter went into the woods, and he got lost because he was looking for a deer. And then what happened is that he went into a deep sleep because he had to camp out, and this woodpecker came, and he followed the woodpecker, and it plucked out holes in this tree, cedar tree, which is made out of cedar, and the wind blew, and it made this beautiful sound. So the woodpecker showed him how to make the flute, but also he was in love with this girl, and he was shy, so he learned how to play the flute, and then he went to her dwelling and played the flute for her, and then they became talked, and then they fell in love. So in the village of the Lakotas or whatever the flute came from, every man learned how to play this flute so he can court a girl. So that's the whole story.
There's always a backstory that involves love.
Huh? The love flute or the spirit flute.
That's all right. David Arnett Cherry is my very special guest. It's great to have David join us. This next track Well, earlier on, if you've been with us throughout, we paid homage to the great literary giant, Mr. Langston Hughes. We now want to return to the Hillsborough story and put the spotlight on another giant. Specifically, we're talking about civil rights activist, attorney, judge, state senator. What a remarkable woman, Ms. Constance Baker Motley. And David paid tribute to this extraordinary woman with this next track. Check this out. Remarkable woman.
Yeah.
And I think you captured kind of the spirit that she had to endure and deal with as a jurist.
Yeah, and you know, with the Hillsborough, you know, when Thurgood Marshall hired her on the spot to go and deal with the Hillsborough story, mm-hmm. she walked in and it was kind of hard with the Brown versus Education because they was really creating civil rights on the spot. And it was nothing to go by, really.
No precedence.
No precedent. Mm-hmm. But she had this elegance, and I was really trying to, and people should research her more. But I just want to bring out the elegance and how she persevered. How mm-hmm. she was very. You have to be like diligent, and we come from that where they have to be better than better mm-hmm. do the things that they did, which was phenomenal.
Phenomenal.
So, absolutely. The Hillsboro Story, check it out.
By the way, on this particular track that paid tribute to Constance Baker Motley, you had Justo Amario, in this case on clarinet. You heard Justo earlier on tenor saxophone. Roberto Miranda on bass. The gentleman I like to call the house drummer of jazz in the modern era, Mr. Don Littleton, who, if you've been with us for the last few years, Don has performed very, very often with, among others, Charles Owens. And on piano, my special guest, Mr. David Ornette Cherry, a tribute to Constance Baker Motley. The track is simply called Her Name is Motley. Set up this next video, please, David.
Well, this is called Internet, E-N-T-E-R dash N-E-T, and it's on one of my records, Internet, but this is the feature tune, which is featuring the great poet from the Watch Prophets, I'm D, and we said we want to work together again, because he worked with them in the 90s with my dad, and I was worked with them doing their music, so I called him earlier this year and said, let's do something, so we put it together real fast, and it's dealing with, he's a great poet, great writer, and it's dealing with the simple fact of the internet, and it's very profound. So I'm going to let him say what he has to say on it, as being one of the Watch Prophets, but also it's featuring a Portland artist named Jack Davis, Jack Quincy Davis, which is a great visualized video artist, and he's very political. And he has a new documentary that, if you look up Jack Quincy Davis, will be coming out, and is dealing with Iraq war and just war and politics and a lot of things. But this is like, this piece is very profound. And I'm very happy to say that this is going to be the debut of this video tonight on Chet's show. And we saved it for him to debut it. My friend here, so
I'm humbled by that, David. Thank you. Open up your ears and open up your minds, folks. This is Internet. Check this out.
Each and every day, in an enthusiastic way, that the Internet set modern man free, like a dog. Now, this state would completely confuse me. This wind, my friend, has a net that anything free. Now my simpleness I regret, but where's the freedom in a net? Fighters we wear, fishermen they net, boats are trapped, the spider knows all and where. He keeps it in sight day or night, wrapped real, real tight, with a click. Is it online or inline? Download or unload? Where is the freedom? In the net. Stealth crafted in your lap. Net zero heroes guide. L-N-L-E-L-L-L-L. Processing your personal soul for info. No telling where it goes. Only the net maker really knows. Now, you used to be able to shred it. But now that's gone. A hard drive is always alive. Wrapped real, real tight. With a click and a bite, Spider-Man can pull you up tonight. Free man is freely ending a net. One day experience regret. Because there's no freedom in a net. Fishermen control their net. Spiders control their web. Who, my friend, controls the World Wide Web? Yuri! What spider has you in his website? Wrapped real, real tight. A click and a bite. Wrapped real, real tight. We'll be right back.
Internet. Wow. Hopefully you were listening carefully. Some pretty profound lyrics to some extraordinary visual wizardry.
Yeah.
That's what that was.
Yeah.
And, you know, when you think about the computer and the Internet and the upside, but there's also a scary side, huh, David?
Yes, definitely. via the Amdi from the Wise Prophets.
Yes, indeed.
You know, so, you know.
When did you guys put that together, David?
We put it together pretty much at the beginning of the year of 2010.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to do something dealing with the net foot, and also it was a new coming out of the organic journey and all this. I still wanted to touch the world music electronics thing,
right,
and where we are in that. And AMD, like I said, we got reconnected, and we did it over the internet. So he did his vocals over the internet, it was like a good experiment, and the visuals are great,
yeah.
And it's just food for thought.
Food for thought, bingo. Bottom line.
There you are.
Speaking of food for thought, those of you enrolled, I still haven't heard from a few of you, letting me know when you plan. Actually, letting me know who your artist is that you selected for your project, either your audio or video biography. You see that due date, it's right around the corner, so please give me a call or email me and let me know who your artist is, and if you need any assistance in putting together your audio or video biography, that's why I'm there. No term papers, no. This is something that you're going to have to do a little work for on the audio or video side. And if you're at a total loss, give me a call, and I will help you as best I can. My hope is that all of you who are enrolled receive via email some specifics that I'm looking for in your project. So please get on that. In addition, some of you were expecting me to deal with the trumpeters. I will definitely come back and deal with some of the great trumpet players, trombone players, and other brass artists in a future broadcast. We are rapidly running short of time. I want to thank my very special guest. Good to see you again, David Arnett,
sir. Thank you for inviting me.
Oh, man, you're always welcome when you come to town.
Good times, man.
Yes,
times,
indeed. You know. We have more as much fun just talking between tracks while you're enjoying the music listening to the music. But I'm always happy when David comes in and shares his extraordinary vision for this music with all of us here in Southern California. We're going to close things out. Speaking of David Arnett Cherry, a little thing called New Space.
Because I just got me, I'm just announcing this, I just got me an African name from Ghana.
Ah.
Kwasi Kwumba Ofari, meaning man born on a Sunday, who was blessed by God with creativity, honor, and courage, reawakened. So my whole thing is reawakening, so I hope the nation and the world reawakens to freshness and positive things.
Absolutely. I couldn't have said it better.
Mm-hmm.
We'll see you next Tuesday, 9 o'clock sharp. Thank you for tuning in. Enjoy the rest of your week.
Mm-hmm.